In this video, we're going to talk about the Kraft Insulin Survey. We've mentioned it many times, but we've never really gone through a full who, what, why, when, and where. That's what we'll do in this video. We'll also talk about Joseph Kraft's book, The Diabetes Epidemic and You. just briefly, who do we do these for? People who I suspect insulin resistance for one reason or another, but it's not showing up very clearly in the standard tests, fasting blood glucose, triglyceride over HDL, even OGTT. John Rorschider was one of those folks, as we mentioned before. He came in and said, "Doc, I know you ask about insulin resistance and prediabetes. I check it every year. My doc checks it every year. We know what we're doing. We don't have it." We did the Kraft Insulin Survey, and his blood sugar went up over 200, actually close to 300. He realized at that point that he had not only insulin resistance, but full-blown diabetes, and covered that in several of his videos. Now, so those are the kind of situations where we'd want to look at this. What is it? We'll go into detail on the tests in just a few minutes. Why? Again, we've covered that in other videos. Basically, if someone has insulin resistance or full-blown diabetes, they clearly are not somebody that should be eating glycemic carbs at will. That's something they need to be very much familiar with, and they need to start tracking their blood sugars using continuous glucose monitoring like the Freestyle Libre. So where do you do it? You can do it from your own home. We've also worked out something with Quest Labs where we do something very similar. It's a three-hour insulin survey. We've done a couple of videos on that. Again, John covered one. I've done a couple of videos where I actually looked. John's covered the book. Mine covers more of the history and the test results itself. So the history, it was developed by a doctor named Joseph Kraft. He was a pathologist, the head of a large lab in a large hospital in Chicago a couple of decades ago. He wrote a book, The Diabetes Epidemic in You. It was based on about 15,000 glucose tolerance tests that he did in his lab. These folks were people that had been referred to the lab by their docs for glucose tolerance testing. Now, he did something a little bit different. The normal OGTT has 75 grams of glucose. You go in, you're NPO or nothing by mouth for 8 hours. Then you go in, you get a fasting glucose, and then a fasting glucose takes 75 grams of the sugary water, and then test the blood sugar again at least 1 hour and 2 hours. The Kraft prediabetes profile or insulin survey is different in a couple of ways. You still do the nothing by mouth for 8 hours. You still do the fasting blood sugar, but instead of a 75 gram drink, you get 100 grams of glucose in that drink. And instead of 2 hours, you get 3 hours or even a four-hour test. And instead of just looking at glucose, every time you're drawing blood, you're also looking at insulin so we can follow the insulin pattern and the amount of insulin that your body is putting out in order to manage that blood sugar. You can do this at home through one of the labs that we work with, Meridian Valley Lab, or we now have something that we've negotiated with Quest Labs to get it done in the reference lab. Now, as John mentioned in his video and some other folks have said, well, my doc said this was rigged to fail. 100 grams of glucose, well, or even 75 for the OGTT. Well, again, 120-ounce bottle of soda is 78 grams of carbs. And guess what? If you go to Mickey D's and get a value meal, you get 190 carbs. 95 of those are sugars. So you got to watch out and think a little bit more deeply about what you're eating and what you're drinking. Now, let's go into the results of the book and the chapters itself. I wanted to cover some of that with you so you begin to understand why we keep referring back to this book. Out of those, 14,000 tests that he did, he kept fairly good numbers, and we'll go through some of the translation on what he saw. Each chapter of about, chapters 31 through 35 or so, looks at a decade of life. So in other words, this is the decade of life, 51 to 60-year-olds. In the number of these Kraft Insulin Surveys he did that were in patients 51 to 60 was 2,413. The number out of that that had a normal glucose tolerance was 1,300. So just over half had a normal glucose tolerance. Impaired tolerance was 602, and diabetes, full-blown diabetes, was 508. The mean out of that group was 56 years, and it goes on to tell how many women, how many men. It tells a little bit more about the procedure itself, and it says the procedure was ordered by the physician to exclude or diagnose prediabetes or diabetes. Now, here's a little bit of confusion, and I will try to clear that up for you. The results were critiqued with the American Diabetes Association guidelines for fasting blood glucose and oral glucose. So what he's saying here is this. They looked at the fasting blood glucose. If it was less than 100, ADA guidelines said you didn't need to be testing any further, so you didn't need an oral glucose tolerance test. If that had been applied to this group of 51 to 60-year-olds, 69% would not have been tested. So 69% of these people had had a fasting blood glucose of 100 or less. So again, most labs would say, well, you don't need to do an OGTT. Well, again, as he showed in the beginning, almost half of them had an abnormal glucose tolerance test. Or Kraft Insulin Survey. So that's the point that you begin to see. And actually, even docs in standard medicine these days understand fasting blood glucose by itself is not an adequate test. If you look at mine, for example, in March of 2019, my fasting blood glucose was 84. It looked great. But at 1 hour post oral glucose tolerance, or post 75 grams of sugar, my blood sugar went up to 184. So I'd be in one of those groups. That's just a repeat on those. Let's look at, oh, no, it's not. It's the 41 to 50 age group. So as you see, one of the things that you'll see as I go through these next few chapters is this is very much an age-related issue. I've said many times in many different videos, most of us tend to think, well, the diabetes and prediabetes epidemic is really caused by obesity. And I keep saying, if you look at aging, aging is probably a bigger issue. The fastest growing group of Americans is centenarians, 100-year-olds. And let's look at aging over the next three or four slides. 41 to 50 year age group. Out of 1,925, the normals were 1,231. So again, significantly over half were normal there. Maybe what, 60%? Actually over 60%. In the 51 to 60 age group, which we covered just a few minutes ago, now that's dropping. It's 1,302 normals over 2,400. Getting a little bit closer to half. Okay, now that we get up to the 61 to 70 year age group, 827 normal out of 1,720. And pardon these numbers have gotten moved around a little bit. N is 1,720, normal glucose was 827, impaired glucose was 464, and full-blown diabetes glucose intolerance was 429. So as you can see, at this point, between ages 60 and 70, less than half have a normal insulin resistance or OGTT, Kraft Insulin Survey, or more than half have insulin resistance or prediabetes. You know what? You remember the book that we've mentioned many times, Jenny Rule, Blood Sugar 101, where she says, look, by the time we're age 60, half of us have insulin resistance. That's from experience that they've seen with tens of thousands of diabetics. And if you look at numbers from the CDC, just using hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose, those numbers would indicate it's a third of all adults age 30 to and above in the country, or 84 million of us. If you look at the UCLA study in California, it's over half have prediabetes, starting at age 30. So you start looking at these numbers and you start realizing, dang, if you did an insulin, Kraft insulin survey on these people, how many more would you find with insulin resistance? And as you start looking at age groups, what's going on there? In the 71 to 80 year old age group, this is, you look at this and okay, out of a total N of 932, the normals were just over a third. So two thirds of the people had insulin resistance and or complete diabetes. So again, I hope that helps give you some perspective. Now, it's not entirely comparable. And before you start saying, well, wait a minute, Brewer, those, let's just stop and think just a minute. How were these numbers obtained? These were docs referring a patient where they had some sort of suspicion. So the numbers are not totally comparable to either the CDC or the UCLA numbers. And the CDC and UCLA numbers are not totally comparable. But again, what they do show is significant increase in insulin resistance and diabetes as we age. And they also show the old normals or the old tests like fasting blood glucose just are not adequate. The 81 to 90-year-old group, out of a total of 210, only 65, less than a third at this point, have normal glucose tolerance. So one other thing that he showed in his, as he went back and analyzed these numbers and these, 14,000 tests that he did, was some significant patterns. And these patterns you see because it's an insulin survey. In other words, he kept getting the insulin tests at the same time he was getting the glucose tests. This is a normal at zero or fasting blood sugar. Blood sugar's around 80. After a half hour, went up, peaked at about at 120, came down to just around 100 for 1 hour and the 2 hour, and then dropped down below to 80 or so. At the same time, blood insulin went from 2 or 3 up to 50 at peak, and then again began to come back down. That was normal pattern. Pattern 2, the blood sugars started going up to 140, and this was at an hour. It was delayed. As you can see, the next three patterns do show a delay. A half-hour delay, a one-hour delay, and a two-hour delay. Now, what does that mean? Well, there are different levels. Again, if you read Jenny Rule's book, there are different levels of or different time periods of insulin response. Our body does store insulin. So when we get challenged with an increasing blood sugar, there's an immediate release of that stored insulin, and then after that, the pancreas begins to make more insulin. So what you're seeing here appears to be decreased, further and further decreases in that stored insulin response. And what's happening then is it's taking longer and longer in patterns 2, 3A, 3B, and 3A and 3B to get that insulin built up so it takes in the blood sugar down and manages the blood sugar. Now, he showed pattern 4 as well, where the numbers went way up, went to 250 for blood sugar, and also went way high for insulin as well, and that he labeled as hyperinsulinemia. So that is actually true resistance, where your blood sugars are going up, your insulin values are going way up as well, but your blood sugars are just not coming down. Now, that's considered to be a late stage of prediabetes or insulin resistance. In fact, that is often coming right before a time when the beta cells in the pancreas have just worn out. They're not making insulin anymore or significant amounts. With that pattern, insulinopenic is what they call it, penia meaning very little. It's making very little insulin at that point. The blood sugar is going up to 300. Meanwhile, the insulin is still not making it up to 50. So I've traveled very quickly through this survey. Some of it may sound a little bit confusing. If it is, please make some comments below and I'll see if I can clear those up. If you've made it this far, thank you again for your interest. If you hit the like button, and for sure, if you subscribe or share, the algorithm reads that as a strong message that humans think this is interesting and important information. And the algorithm can share it more than any of us humans. speaking of sharing, one of the best ways of sharing is on social media. We've got active Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn activities going on right now. We've recently started up things in Pinterest and Twitter, so we'd love to see you there. Check us out. Finally, with over 500 videos, a lot of people are saying, I can't find this video or that video. Our new social media manager, Kim Hermosa, is starting to work on ways to help with that. So join the community. You can click on the links below and you can get a little bit better access. Thank you again for your interest.